Okay, I think we'll get started. I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Chela Saya, and I am a study abroad advisor at UW-Stout's Office of International Education. Joining me is your fellow Blue Devil, Dion Cannon, who is both a former Stout Student Association president and a recent Gilman scholarship recipient. He'll be talking with you a bit later. Andrea Morse, the Interim Assistant Director of Study Abroad, is also here, and she will be monitoring your questions in the chat. Before we get into the session, I'd like to take care of just a few housekeeping items. First, we are recording this session, and if you aren't comfortable with that, you can access the recording when we share it on our YouTube channel later this week. Second, if you have questions, please do type them into the chat, or wait to share them towards the end of the session by turning on your microphone. Dion and I will be happy to answer your questions at that time, and if we're not able to get to your question or answer it, then I'll certainly take your information and follow up with you later. Finally, please do keep yourself on mute until the question portion of the session at the end to preserve the sound quality for all of the participants. In case you're not familiar with us, the Office of International Education is located in 70 Harvey Hall in the garden level corner you see here, and we support students who wish to study abroad through international exchange, direct enroll programs, faculty-led programs, virtual programs, as well as international internships, field experiences, and co-ops. We also support students who wish to study elsewhere in the United States, such as through faculty-led programs or the National Student Exchange. In addition, our office supports international student admissions and offers the English as a Second Language Institute. Our office, and specifically the Study Abroad team, would be your resource and support for researching, choosing, and applying for a study abroad program, especially if you find you're interested in applying for the Benjamin A. Gilman Scholarship, which is our focus today. The Gilman Scholarship, which offers awards of up to $5,000, is a U.S. Department of State program with funding provided by the U.S. government that has been running since 2001. And since that time, it has become the nation's largest undergraduate scholarship program, supporting U.S. students of high financial need to participate in study abroad programs and international internships. By supporting undergrads who have high financial need, this program has been very successful in supporting students who historically have been underrepresented in education abroad, including first-generation college students, students in STEM fields, ethnic minority students, students with disabilities, students attending historically Black colleges or universities or minority-serving universities, students attending community colleges, and students coming from U.S. states with less study abroad participation overall. Since the program's start in 2001, more than 33,000 bright and diverse American students have received a Gilman scholarship to study or intern abroad in more than 150 countries and hail from more than 1,300 universities across the country. Of these recipients, 47% have been first-generation college students and 65% represent racial or ethnic minority groups. With that broad overview, I'm going to let a Gilman scholar tell you about his experience with this scholarship to give you a clearer picture of what this program offers. I'm going to be sharing a video, so just give me a moment, please, as I share that particular screen. Sorry, one more time. We'll be right back.
Hey everyone, my name is Tan, and I'm currently a second year at UC Berkeley with a double major in Media Studies and Social Welfare. This summer, I'm on an exchange program that allows me to not only study at the National University of Singapore, but also intern at OMD Media Agency for 2 months.
Growing up, I knew I wanted to do something related to multimedia, so this internship is right up my alley. OMD is a media agency that works with multiple companies, ranging from McDonald's to Habro's toy company, to create multimedia campaigns to help solve the company's problems. I hope to be able to participate in the behind-the-scenes process in these campaigns in order to learn more about how the media industry works, and ultimately just use my passion in filmmaking and multimedia to contribute to the team. Singapore has been absolutely amazing so far. So I have never traveled to Asia before, so this has been such an eye-opening experience to see a place so multiculturally diverse like Singapore. At my internship, I see so many different groups of people working with each other, and that type of communication really amazes me to see how efficient the workplace is, even with people from different backgrounds and cultures. So I am so excited to gain more skills in terms of working with a diverse group of people in a team-oriented and fast-paced environment in order to pursue a career in the entertainment industry. Studying abroad has always been one of my biggest goals since high school, but I didn't realize how expensive it would be. But thankfully, I found out about the Gilman scholarship through my study abroad office at my university, and it has definitely helped me immensely in this studying abroad journey. So the Gilman scholarship aims to help underrepresented students with high financial need study abroad by providing awards up to $5,000. And for me, coming from a low-income and first-generational background, I didn't have the financial support in order to study abroad. And with the Gilman Scholarship, which provided me $4,500, I was able to make my dream of studying abroad come to life.
I can't wait to show you more video of my life here in Singapore. Come follow me on my journey in the Lion City.
Okay, just a moment as I get back to the PowerPoint presentation. Okay, now let's talk about Gilman eligibility requirements. An applicant must be a citizen of the United States, an undergraduate student in good standing at an accredited institution of higher education, which of course UW-Stout is, but a student must be receiving a federal Pell Grant during the time of application or provide proof that they will be receiving a Pell Grant during the time that they will be studying abroad or interning abroad. The student must be in the process of applying to or already have been accepted to a study abroad or internship program of at least 3 weeks that is eligible for credit from the student's home institution. Proof of program acceptance will be required prior to disbursement of the award. You should note that fall, spring, summer, winter, academic year programs are all possible as long as they meet the other requirements. In addition, for this application cycle, since COVID-19, virtual programs will also be considered. Finally, the students must be applying for a program that is in a country or area with an overall travel advisory level of 1 or 2, according to the Department of State's travel advisory system. Now, again, during COVID-19, there has been a slight exception to this rule. If you are interested in studying in a country that currently is at a level 3 or level 4, specifically due to COVID-19, you can still apply to study in that country with the expectation that when the program actually occurs, by that time, the travel advisory level should have come down to level 1 or 2 due to improvements in the situation of COVID-19. If the situation of COVID-19 has not improved in that country enough to decrease the advisory level, then the Gilman program will give you an option to choose another program and country. Next, I want to clarify that while there is one scholarship program, there are actually several award paths that you can take. Through the Central Gilman Scholarship, recipients can receive up to $5,000 to use towards program costs and related expenses, such as tuition and fees, room and board, books, local transportation, health insurance, international airfare, as well as passport and visa fees. Personal expenses such as entertainment, electronics, and personal excursions outside of the program would not be eligible. Award amounts thus vary depending on the student's need for their chosen program and the selection process. Another path is to pursue the Critical Need Language Award, which would, if granted, give the student an additional $3,000. I will explain that option in the next slide. A third path is the Gilman McCain Scholarship, which awards participants a flat $5,000. In other words, the award amount does not vary. Again, I will get into detail in the coming slides. Applicants to the Gilman Scholarship Program who are studying a language that has been identified as a critical need for our government and are doing so in a country in which the language is predominantly spoken can apply for a supplemental award of up to $3,000 for a combined total of up to $8,000. In addition to receiving those extra funds for language study, the student who wins this award and completes their Gilman Scholarship requirements will be offered the opportunity to take an oral proficiency interview. This test and its results are a very valuable credential for the student, both in their future academic path and career path. Currently, there are 15 languages deemed critical, and they are shown in this slide. They range from Arabic and Urdu, from Chinese, Japanese, and Korean to Portuguese and Swahili. Please note that to apply for this additional award, the applicant would need to submit an additional essay. The Gilman McCain Scholarship provides awards of a flat $5,000 per child dependent of U.S. active duty service members to study or intern abroad on credit-bearing programs of 3 weeks or more in countries at a travel advisory level of 1 or 2. It's important to note here that this award is open to eligible students who receive any type of Title IV federal financial aid. So that requirement is in contrast to the Central Gilman Scholarship, which specifically requires that the student receive the Pell Grant. To apply, students use the same online Gilman application system, which I will describe later, though there will be a question that asks if they are a child dependent of an active duty service member. They simply check that box and later they will be required to submit proof of documentation. Besides being a child dependent of an active duty service member and having any type of Title IV federal financial aid, all other eligibility requirements are the same as the Central Gilman Scholarship. However, you should note that there are only 100 of the Gilman McCain Awards for the entire academic year that are dispersed. For more information, I encourage you to visit the website shown on this slide or to email me. I'll be providing my email at the end of this session. Before we go into the details of the application process, I want to take a brief pause again to hear about a day in the life of a Gilman scholar. So again, just give me a moment to change screens. Sorry about that. All right. Oh, sorry. I'm having a little issue here. Just a moment. One more time.
You got a minute, just take a sit and I'll explain to you just how I did it.
Hey,
Welcome to my civilian life. This is where the meals go down, the blogs go up, and the Spanish is practiced. It's crazy how in just a semester, this place has started to feel just like home. I couldn't have asked for a better homestay family or roommate or group of friends. My room is where my day begins always, sunny with the civilian sun, and also the set of majority of my blogs. The rooftop is either where I do my blogs, we get fresh food for dinner, we hang our clothes, or I do homework because it's so relaxing. I take classes at CIEE, my study abroad provider's location, or at CICUS, which is a part of the University of Sevilla. Either way, the civilian sun welcomes us every day. Otto is the main cafe where my friends and I meet to talk, do homework, grab a bite to eat, and sometimes rap for my blogs.
If at first we did class, yo, I think I made pass. Even though they're in Spanish, I think I made last. Journalism is my passion, it's like, yo, on the side. When I walk into class, it's like, oh, my boy, we're proud. I came to Seville, just came for the drill, having the time of my life. We really being real.
It's so easy to get lost in the streets of Spain with its beauty and antique grace. Although I've been here for 3 months, every day feels like an adventure. I'm constantly finding new things. When my friends and I have free time, we're exploring the city and parks, traveling, or just taking in the sun. I couldn't imagine a better study abroad experience than here in Seville.
Okay, just give me a moment to get back to the PowerPoint slides. Okay, now I'll be describing the application and you'll have a chance to hear from your fellow Blue Devil Dion Cannon. The entire application process is conducted online and has two major steps. Step one is the online application, which the student completes and asks for details of the study abroad program or international internship that you wish to complete. It requires 3 essays and an undergraduate transcript. I'll be talking about the essays in more detail a bit later. Please note that the Gilman program does require transcripts for applicants' current institution, UW-Stout, as well as transcripts from any previous institutions attended. This step also requires applicants to select a study abroad advisor and a financial aid advisor, specifically identified at UW-Stout. Their role is found in step 2. Once the student has submitted the application, basically, the study abroad advisor will confirm that the program chosen satisfies all requirements by UW-Stout as well as the Gilman program. The financial aid advisor will confirm that the student meets the financial requirements of receiving the Pell Grant or any type of Title IV federal financial aid in the case of a Gilman-McCain applicant. So you may be asking, how are students chosen and what are my chances? On average, 1 in 4 students who apply are ultimately awarded a scholarship. However, this rate does vary each application cycle based on the applicant pool. So for example, in Dion's recent application cycle, there were about 7,000 applicants and ultimately 2,400 recipients. So that works out in the last cycle to about a 34% chance. Now, let me tell you what the Gilman program is looking for in its recipients and specifically in those essays that you would be writing. Each application cycle, a couple hundred study abroad advisors across the country are asked to serve on review panels to read all of the essays of those thousands of applicants. Each panelist may be assigned to read and rate 60 to 70 different applications. Later, those panelists convene to make a consensus recommendation on whether to award the scholarship. Earlier this year, I actually had the honor of serving as a Gilman panelist, which I feel will ultimately help me better advise you on your application and also to provide any feedback on your essays if you wish. We were asked to base our selection of the applicants on four major criteria. First is the impact of the program and the destination on the student's academic, career, and personal path or trajectory. Second is the impact of the student on the community abroad, as well as on the student's community back at home upon their return. Third is their academic preparedness. Fourth is the diversity of their background and experience. If you apply for the Critical Need Language Award, there'd also be a fifth criterion through which you'd have to demonstrate a strong motivation and commitment to proficiency in the language after your return. Now let me describe the essays, which are the means by which you would demonstrate these criteria. Keep in mind that you'll be submitting three essays, four if you're applying for that Critical Need Language Award. These essays are so important because for selection panelists like me earlier this year, these essays are our way, our only way of getting to know who you are and your reasons for studying abroad. The Gilman program does provide prompts, basically some questions for inspiration for you to address as you're writing each essay. The first essay, the statement of purpose, has a maximum of 7,000 characters, which is roughly about a page and a half. This essay is essentially a personal interview on paper, and it addresses the first, third, and fourth criteria that I just went over on the previous slide. You should talk about the impact of study abroad on your academic goals, professional goals, and personal growth, as well as how the Gilman Scholarship and the program you chose can help you achieve those goals. You should establish a very, very clear and coherent link between the program and your goals. It's also a good idea to touch upon what inspired you to study abroad in the first place and any challenges you have faced in trying to include study abroad as part of your education. In this essay, you should also demonstrate that you are academically prepared to complete the program you've chosen. Keep in mind, though, that there is no minimum GPA required for this scholarship. That being said, panelists will look at students' performance, they'll review their transcripts, and specifically look at their grades in the courses they're taking in their major. In order to assess if the student has the maturity necessary to succeed in the program chosen. I want to add that if a student has had some academic struggles, that's not necessarily a disqualifier. However, it would be a good idea if that student would briefly address the challenges that they've faced and explain how they are addressing them. So, for example, if in the past semester your grades dropped because you were taking a full course load, working, and also doing an internship, you can address that in your essay. Finally, the program seeks participation by the broadest group of undergrads with financial need as possible. Therefore, it's important in this particular essay to describe the challenges you have faced and what makes you unique. So, for example, if you are a first-generation college student, if you are a female student in a STEM field where women have been historically underrepresented, if you are a student with a disability, here's where you tell your story. Preference is also given to those who have not studied abroad before and to veterans who have served on active duty in the U.S. Armed Forces. The second and third essays address community impact, which you may recall was the second evaluation criterion. Let me give you a bit of background on this focus. The U.S. Department of State, which is the agency that supports this scholarship program, aims to increase mutual understanding between the people of the United States and the people of other countries. And it believes that the Gilman program plays a role in helping it achieve that mission, because study abroad ultimately is a form of diplomacy. But while abroad, you will reflect the diversity of values, beliefs, and opinions that is fundamental to providing a balanced representation of the United States. Therefore, Gilman scholars are expected to contribute to this mission by sharing what it means to be an American with those they meet abroad, learning about the host culture, and building meaningful relationships. In your essays, you will need to explain how you plan to do that. In this second essay, then, you'll explain how you will be a U.S. citizen diplomat as a Gilman scholar, and how you will seek opportunities to become more culturally engaged while abroad and have meaningful interactions with people from different cultures. This essay has a maximum of 3,000 characters. Upon returning to the United States, Gilman scholars have the opportunity and really responsibility to inspire the next wave of students to study or intern abroad. Therefore, as part of this program, Gilman scholars are required to complete a follow-on service project. The goal of this project is for the Gilman scholars to increase awareness of study abroad and the Gilman scholarship in particular among their peers in their home communities and their home campuses. A successful follow-on service project will be both creative but also feasible. It will utilize the students' experience abroad and connect to diverse groups of Americans here at home. In this essay, you will explain how you will represent and promote the Gilman program upon your return home. You must map out the potential project to encourage others to study abroad or intern abroad and spread awareness of the scholarship. This project can be completed either at UW-Stout or in your local community, but it must be completed within 6 months of your return to the United States. The Gilman program advises students to use activities and organizations that you're already involved with as inspiration, such as student clubs, academic departments, or community organizations. So you're encouraged to begin the discussions with key contacts in those organizations, even prior to being awarded the scholarship. For example, while you are drafting this essay. This essay has a maximum of 3,000 characters. Now, I know that the application and perhaps the project might seem intimidating, but I want you to keep in mind that not only is there a huge potential payout, but there are other benefits to consider as well. In fact, even if you apply for the Gilman and don't actually get it, there are potential benefits. For example, if you choose to study abroad through the provider CIEE, they offer a Gilman Go Global scholarship. And basically what you need to provide is proof of an eligible Gilman application to work towards that scholarship. And of course, the essays that you are so carefully writing for this scholarship are wonderful building blocks to apply for the dozens, if not hundreds, of scholarships that are available to study abroad. And I'd point you towards our website because we have a finances page there that lists all of these hundreds of scholarships that you could use these essays to apply for. But if you are awarded the Gilman, not only will you receive the funds of up to $5,000, you also have a number of other benefits. One is if you study abroad through the provider API, they offer a matching scholarship of $1,000. So now you're looking at perhaps close to $6,000 total. Other benefits include, and these are offered through the Gilman program, non-competitive eligibility for 1 year, and that is a preferred hiring status with the federal government that has the possibility of extension for up to an additional 2 years. Another benefit is the Gilman Scholar Network, which is the official site for Gilman scholars and alumni to connect with each other via a secure and private online platform. Gilman scholars can search for fellow alumni by categories such as the location, college or university attended, country where they studied, and their career industry. Gilman scholars can also request mentorship from more experienced alumni, or later on, they can offer mentorship to younger alumni or new scholars. The Gilman Scholar Network also gives access to exclusive job postings. That's key. Another benefit is access to exclusive seminars and career workshops where you can build your skills, network with other alumni, and learn about yet more career opportunities. Finally, through the Gilman Alumni Ambassador Program, you can apply to serve for 1 year as an official representative of the Gilman program. You would provide testimonials about your experience with the scholarship at campus presentations and offer application tips through written articles, videos, webinars, and special events. And at the end of the session, I'm going to tell you when you can hear from a Gilman Alumni Ambassador this week, this Wednesday. Now, I know that perhaps these benefits might seem abstract, and so what better way to actually make them more real but to hear from your fellow Blue Devil, Dion Cannon. So at this point, I'd like to have Dion turn on his microphone so I can ask him a few questions.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Thanks, Dion.
Perfect.
Thank you so much for being here. I thought I could ask you to start by just telling us what course you are taking using the funds from the Gilman Scholarship.
Yeah, so I'm taking World Cultural History at Richmond, the American International University in London. It's pretty much a course that talks about the Bronze and Iron Age, and we pretty much give our opinions. So my first essay is about what I think is an ancient civilization. And it's just really interesting because it reminds me a lot of my courses at Stout, where it's me giving my argument for why I think this is an accurate tool for like evaluating what a civilization is. It was a fun essay, and I really enjoyed doing it. But we're going through the Bronze Age next week, and then we'll be ending out the semester in the Iron Age. So.
And are the students that you're taking this course with, are they all British students or is it a mix?
Yeah, so the class is async. I can't remember the last part of that, but so pretty much I do it on my own time. Unfortunately, I chose a country who doesn't fit well with American sleeping pattern. While they up at 10 a.m., I'm sleeping at 4 a.m. So I would be able to join in my class with my peers if I was able to get up at 4 a.m., but I also work at 8 a.m., so I just wasn't able to do it. But I believe it's a mix because it's a pretty renowned university over there, and it takes a lot of different students from the United States as well.
Right. I wanted to just add a quick note that because of COVID-19, you had to do sort of a last-minute pivot, like I talked about earlier in the session, where the Gilman program gave you the option of switching from an in-person program to a virtual program. I wanted to ask you, Dion, what do you feel for you personally has been the biggest benefit of the Gilman?
Personally, I think the funds. I'm probably talking about this later too, but I was super afraid. So I'm a super senior here. Pretty much for the past 4 years, I was always afraid to do study abroad just because I couldn't afford it. And then I knew it was like an application fee and all of those things was like hesitant. Like I think it was like $150 for the application fee. And I was like, oh, do I really just want to like put my funds towards this? And I may not get accepted to my program of choice. And then this year, this prior year, I finally got up the courage and start actually applying to scholarships. And one of the things that also appeared to me was my freshman year, I had like a 2.5, so my grades wasn't that good. But then I slowly got it up. So a lot of like compounding effects gave me more confidence. But like the biggest benefits I see from Gilman is some of the alumni benefits. I was looking at the mentorship right now. Even though I'm currently in my class, just trying to figure out like who can I connect with, because I'll be looking for a job pretty soon. So kind of see what opportunities lies from that.
Yeah, I think what's great about this program is, of course, there's the huge benefit immediately as you're taking, you know, the course of the program, but the benefits extend a lot farther into the future, really. So that's great. I was going to ask if you have any particular tips for the application. I know when you applied, there were just the two essays, and now it's been split into the three, but it's still the same topic. So what tips do you have for your fellow Blue Devils?
Yeah, so my first tip would be to write down your draft in a Word document. Don't use the Gilman Scholarship essay submission, because it'll delete if you don't save it or something like that. I just know you don't do it there. Use a Word document and you won't have your stuff erased and all your hard work. But write down a bad rough draft. Just write down your story. Write down anything with no grammar. Don't try to fix anything. Don't try to clean it up. Like, wait until the last the last minute to start doing that changes. You want to get your ideas down. You want to get your story with free from the restrictions of grammar. I think that really helped me pretty much in all of my writings, because I'm really bad with grammar, but being able to just write without that restriction frees me to start getting my creative juices going, I guess. And then the other part is be genuine and be honest. I really hate scholarship essays so much, just because I feel like they a lot of work. But like, this is one of the scholarship essays where I was actually so genuine, so honest. Like, a lot of my words flowed freely. I'll talk about me wanting to go to Japan ever since I learned it back in elementary school. And just bring up a lot of good memories of pretty much why I wanted to go abroad and actually see the world. And so being honest and genuine with yourself really helps your paper. And you also got to understand, this is the only time they'll get to see you. Like, you don't get to talk to them. You don't get to see them, send them anything extra. So you really got to sell yourself. So if, like Jella said, if you're like minority student, if you're first generation, if you're disability, individual with disabilities, you want to say all of that stuff, because they won't be able to see who you actually are. So this is the time where you like really played up some of the things you may not play up in like your normal day-to-day life. And then lastly, utilize extra resources like the Office of International Education, the Writing Center, somebody you trust to look over your paper. After you do your first draft, you start going back in to do editing your grammar and things like that. Give them the writing prompt that the Gilman Scholarship gives you, and then, hey, the actual professor or Writing Center or whoever it is, be like, hey, does this make sense? Does this logically flow? What do you think about this? Because always having an extra set of eyes just really helps you out and creating a nice final draft that the people will read.
Yeah. I want to just underline what you said about telling your story and just being honest. I think as I look back at the essays that I read as a panelist, those are the essays that I remembered. And, you know, then later when I was asked to come back and discuss them with other panelists, you know, if you told a compelling story, it helps us to remember that. And of course, then we're going to end up discussing your essays and your application even more. Dion, I want to leave more time at the end of the session for other students to ask you questions directly. So what I'd like to do right now is just cover a couple final slides with some dates and deadlines, and then bring you back for any questions that we have from other students. Does that sound good?
Sounds good.
Okay, thank you. Okay, for the Gilman Scholarship, there are two deadlines to keep in mind. The applicant deadline, which is the deadline for students to submit their application online, and the advisor deadline, which is the deadline for both of advisors to complete their certifications. Now, there is a current application cycle going on, the October 2020 cycle, and this is for students who are applying to study abroad anytime starting in 2021. Spring 2021, summer 2021, fall 2021, and also if you're interested in studying an academic year, 2021-22. This application cycle opened in mid-August, and the student applicant deadline is October 6th. And please note that that deadline is at 11:59 Pacific time. So luckily here in Central Time, we have a couple extra hours. I know that is soon, but one thing I want to throw out to you as a consideration is there's actually going to be then another application cycle in March, the March 2021 cycle. And that again is for students who are applying to study abroad in 2021, for summer 2021, fall 2021, academic year 2021-22, as well as spring 2022. So one thing to consider, and what I've been hearing other advisors say is a good idea, a good approach, is why not apply both times? You can work real hard in the next couple weeks to apply now by the October 6th deadline. And if you get it, great, you will know that you have this huge financial support to study abroad next year. Or if you don't get it, then you can apply again in March and you already have the building blocks of your essays in place. Now, I do want to share that you do have to consider not only the Gilman application, but of course the deadline for the study abroad program that you're applying to or the international internship that you're applying to. You would apply to your program through our website, which is uwstout.studioabroad.com. Now, different programs vary slightly sometimes on their deadlines, but a general rule of thumb is if you're applying for a winter or spring 2021 program, that deadline is coming up soon in October. If you're applying for summer 2021 or fall 2021 programs, in general, that deadline is in March of next year. So with that, I want to open it up to questions. First, I will ask Andrea, my colleague, to see if she has any questions that she's been collecting in the chat box.
Thank you, Chella. I don't see any questions yet, but I'm happy to assist if the students have any questions.
Okay, thanks. Would anybody like to turn on their microphone and ask either myself or Dion a question?
Chella, I'm not sure if you see in the chat box or not, but just in case, there's a question. What about the requirements for essay number 4?
Right, thanks for asking. So in essay number 4, and actually, I think I have a slide for that. There we go. So in this essay, it's a bit shorter, just 2,000 characters. You're going to need to, of course, address that it is, in fact, one of the 15 currently assessed critical need languages. You'll need to confirm that the country you're going to, that language is predominantly spoken there. You'll want to specifically relate it to your academic or career goals. So for example, if you're wanting to learn Arabic because you are planning to pursue a master's degree in Middle Eastern studies, then you can talk about that in your essay. You want to talk about your motivations for improving your language proficiency. And you also want to talk about how you plan to continue that language study. So they don't want to see a student who just goes and studies for this period of time using the scholarship and then comes back and is not continuing their language study to improve and to maintain it. If any of you have studied a language, you know if you're not using it, you can quickly lose it. So they want to also hear in that essay that you have plans to continue the language development that you start through the study abroad program after you come home. So thanks for that question. Any other questions? Feel free to type into the chat or turn on your microphone. Well, I just wait a minute. If anybody has a question, I'll just put this slide up there that talks about the virtual programs that Gilman is considering as a sort of special situation due to COVID-19. You can see that just like Dion, you can take an online course at an institution based outside the United States. You can also do a virtual program through a provider or an exchange program. You can also do a virtual faculty-led program, a virtual internship, virtual intensive language programs. Really, they have quite a few options. So you would be working still through our office. We have a number of virtual program options available to look at on our website. So again, if you go to uwstout.studioabroad.com, on the homepage, there's a virtual button towards the bottom of the screen that you can click on and see what options you have. Any other questions? Well, I'm going to just share some final details here, but please do stop me, Andrea, if anybody types a question into the chat. Ah, I see one. Would it be good to talk about our major in the essay? Yes. So I assume you're talking about the first essay, the statement of student purpose. So as I mentioned, there is no minimum GPA, but panelists do look at the courses you've taken in your major and how you've done there. And they also want to see a connection between the program that you're taking abroad and your major. So you want to make sure that you're very strategically choosing your program so that they can see that you are either taking courses that are required for your major or somehow complementing your major in some way. So perhaps you are doing a foreign language minor, but majoring in something else, that also would be okay. You just want to talk about how that program is still helping you achieve your academic goals. I found also that as I was reviewing essays, it helped when the students, you know, really were specific about not just, you know, describing their program in general, but saying, I chose this program specifically because I like this aspect of the course. And I was looking, for example, for lab work in my, you know, biology major, and they have a really strong program in Spain. So I would want to suggest to you to make sure that, you know, not going to go into tons of detail. You only have those 3,000 characters, but you want to show that you were very careful and strategic in the choices that you made in choosing a study abroad program. Any other questions? Thanks for that great question. I was just going to say that just to wrap up a little bit, I wanted to share that there are so many ways that you can learn more. First of all, here at UW-Stout, I hope that you have already joined our study abroad fair. You should have received an invite on your Canvas dashboard to join through Canvas. Already you can be researching the programs that are available to you, and you can also be watching pre-recorded videos. But on Wednesday, we have an incredible lineup of live virtual sessions all day long from 9 a.m. to 10 p.m. because we have to accommodate the people that we've invited to participate that are all over the world. So from 9 a.m. to 10 p.m., we're going to be having sessions with universities abroad, representatives there. We're having presentations by Stout faculty who are leading faculty-led programs abroad. We're having representatives from study abroad providers. And we're also having panel discussions with fellow Stout students who are study abroad alumni, as well as experts. And one session that I really hope that you'll attend, particularly in regards to the Gilman, is the one at 7:15, which is with a Gilman ambassador. And that ambassador is going to be there to present, share tips, and also have, you know, time for questions as well. So I do hope that you join us on Wednesday for all of those live events. From Gilman specifically, there's so many resources available. I recall from chatting with Dion earlier that he found a lot of good ideas by going to their website, gilmanscholarship.org, when he was trying to come up with ideas for his follow-on service project. So they will typically share projects that students who were awarded the scholarship have done in the past, so it can get your creative juices flowing. They also post extensively on social media, so I encourage you to follow them. In particular, they've recently started a podcast that I have found very helpful and interesting, and they tend to feature Gilman alumni speaking about their experience and also providing tips. Also, our office, of course, is your resource, and we hope that we can be of support to you. So again, our location is 70 Harvey Hall. But during this time when a lot of us are working virtually, the best way to reach us is either via email, studyabroad@uwstout.edu, or by making a virtual appointment at bit.ly/stout-oie-booking. And you can make an appointment with me to talk about the Gilman or any study abroad program that you're interested in. And of course, please do use our website, uwstout.studioabroad.com, to research your study abroad options. With that, I'm still here if you have any other questions. Dion is here as well. Andrea's here. But I want to thank you for attending, and I hope to see you soon.